I do want to say before we get started that Josh and Steven are associated with a company that's a little bit controversial. And we know that. We invited them anyway because we know them and we see how they treat their employees. And we see how proud they are of what they do. And we want them to share their stories with you. When they're done speaking, we're going to have Q&A. Part of what we do here is we give anybody the chance to stand up and ask any question they want. You're entitled to that. That's what universities do. I just ask that you do it respectfully. Because we're here to talk to each other, not to argue. Okay? So, Chick-fil-A and our two franchisees. This is a series about entrepreneurship. So why do we have this brand, representatives of this brand presenting to you? There is this flavor of entrepreneurship that has to do with franchising, where if you want to get started and you don't necessarily want to start from scratch, there are big companies that will help you get started. You're still your own boss. You have employees. You have a relationship with this company that gives you the brand and helps you buy stuff and tells you how to make, gives you standards for how to make product. But you still have to make an investment yourself, and you're still very much an entrepreneur. So in the interest of bringing that kind of flavor to this series, we wanted to do that. This topic is especially, it means something to me personally. My immigrant family was in the food service business for years. Not this scale, but a little luncheonette in Manhattan. My grandfather started washing dishes at Columbia University. In fact, he used to tell befuddled New Yorkers that he went to Columbia and he loved to see the look on his face as they tried to figure out. He barely speaks English and he's like 35. What's he doing at Columbia? But his dream was to open his own restaurant. I have multiple uncles who owned restaurants. My mom ran a catering business. Those of you who know me know that I'm a part of the Ventura County Greek Festival. In my culture, feeding someone is more than about the food. It's about what you put into the food. It's about in making someone else happy. So that act has more meaning than just a chicken sandwich. So I'm really excited to hear what they have to say tonight. I wanted to mention one more thing. This is unrelated, but we just wanted to recognize that this time last year, our speaker was Emily Barony talking about her startup, Thomas Fire Help, which was about helping people who were the victims of disaster. That night, we all went home, and one of the worst tragedies in this county happened. That's tomorrow. So when you leave here, you go home to your families, you see your friends tomorrow, just keep the people who were affected by the borderline shooting in your hearts and in your prayers. I should have said that first. I should have talked you up a little bit more. But I'm really excited to hear you guys talk about your journeys, Steven and Josh.
All right. Check, check. Can everybody hear me?
Yes.
All right. Good evening. Good evening. So we're here to talk about selling chicken, but not on Sundays. Right. But thank you for being here, investing time in yourselves, investing time in the relationship with the university and as a community as well. I'm Steven Richardson. This is Josh Young. My restaurant is in Westlake Village, and his is in Moore Park Road, like, what, 3 miles down?
Yep, right down.
So if you get hungry after this, he's got a great restaurant not too far from here.
Yeah, we're open until 10, so we'll get out in time.
Yeah, so. Yeah. Yeah, not on Sunday, sorry. You got to wait till Monday. But we're here today to talk about Chick-fil-A's history, our founder's entrepreneurial spirit, our roles as owner-operators, and the slash in between that, owners and operators, and the Chick-fil-A agreement that we have with them. but also talk about the how of what we do, some of our strategies around building the business, some of our leadership strategies, and then I think we'll open it up to some Q&A right after that. So before we dive in, I want to introduce myself. I know what you're thinking. He definitely married up. Yes, I did. But that's my wife, Jordan. These are our three kids. Nolan, he's a little redhead, fireball of energy. And then Charlie, I'm wrapped around her finger already, and it is quite embarrassing. I can't say no to her. And then our newest addition, Harris Benjamin, HB, is 4 weeks old. So despite our lack of sleep, I'm here, fired up to be here, and excited to talk about chicken. So.
Can we just give Steven a round of applause for being here after having him? Thank you. I do remember how that was. I have an almost two-year-old, Emerson, on the far left. She turns two November 24th. Anyways, this is me and my wife, Mallory. We actually met at Chick-fil-A, and I may share a little bit about that in a second. Man, there's a lot of Chick-fil-A love stories if you get involved.
Same.
In Same for you guys, yeah.
In the Chick-fil-A world, we call it a Chick-fil-ationship.
Yeah. So, I literally could not have done this without her. And if any of you have been involved in a family business before, you know that having members of your family help you out with that business is crucial. So that's my wife, Mallory. We have been married for almost 13 years. Emerson on the left and Elliot, who's five, on the right. Both of our kids were born here. And maybe I stand in the wrong place.
I think I got to stay away from you. There we go.
Let me move this down just a bit. There we go. Both of our kids were born here in Thousand Oaks at Los Robles. But my wife and I actually grew up in Atlanta. And that's where we met at Chick-fil-A. So I'll tell you a little bit about my history with Chick-fil-A. So past month, October, I celebrated 21 years with Chick-fil-A. I'm 36 years old, so that's pretty rare to have a 21-year career as a 36-year-old. When I was 15 years old, I started out as a cashier. I grew up in Marietta, Georgia, which is about 25 miles northwest of Atlanta. And I started out as a cashier, just kind of continued working my way up. My wife and I met kind of toward the end of my time of being an employee for a Chick-fil-A owner-operator there in Marietta. And I had the opportunity right after graduating from college to go into a program that Chick-fil-A called the Interim Manager Program. So we'll learn a little bit about the Chick-fil-A agreement. Sorry. Hope nobody's ears are bleeding. we'll tell you a little bit more about the Chick-fil-A agreement as we get into it, but a lot of people that get into Chick-fil-A as owner-operators start out by doing a program that's sort of like a pipeline program. They may work for a Chick-fil-A owner-operator and they see the opportunity and want to do that, so then they go into a program that Chick-fil-A provides to kind of give them the training and ability to do that. So I did that for just over a year. And my wife and I packed up. I remember the end of training. The last day they said, hey, is anybody willing to move for a short term really quickly? This was on a Friday night. And I said, yeah, we could probably go pretty quickly. We were newly married. We had an apartment and not a lot of obligations. And so I went and sat down with the guy who was in charge, Craig Carter. And he said, so we need somebody to go on Tuesday. This was Friday. Can you pack up and leave on Tuesday? I can't tell you about where it's going to be because the existing owner doesn't know that this is happening yet. But they were terminating an agreement with somebody who was underperforming, which very rarely happens in Chick-fil-A's story. It's somewhere kind of in the northeast region, and can you guys be ready to go? And I said, yes. So I called my wife that evening and said, we're moving. So we went to Philadelphia. For about 6 months and ran a mall location there. Came back home and ran a Chick-fil-A in Marietta, which was an existing restaurant where there was an operator who was moving from one location to another location, and it was going to be company owned for a few months in between. Ran that location for 6 months and then had the opportunity to be selected for a mall food court restaurant in Fredericksburg, Virginia, which is about a 10-hour drive up the coast from Atlanta, about an hour south of Washington, D.C. We moved there, and I was the operator at that location for 5 years. and toward the end of that time started looking for opportunities to relocate. A mall restaurant, which we'll also talk about in a little bit, is a great place to get started with your career with Chick-fil-A. Great place to kind of learn the ropes and see how the business goes, but it's a pretty low sales volume situation, and a lot of the sales volume comes in the holidays, as you can imagine. So we started looking to relocate, and I told my wife, if we have to drive a long ways or fly to visit family, where in the country would you like to live? And Southern California was one of the top spots on her list. So we came out and just did a trip, and Thousand Oaks was, we knew it was coming soon, over on Moore Park Road. And Thousand Oaks seemed like a great community to be a part of and raise a family. So in April of 2014, we handed the keys over for that mall location in Fredericksburg, Virginia, packed everything up, drove across the country, and May 29th of 2014, we opened up the location on Moore Park Road, and we've loved it. Thousand Oaks is our new home, and it's where we, you know, plan on raising our kids and spending the rest of our lives, so we really love it here. So that's a little bit about my story. I'll let Steven tell you his Chick-fil-A story.
So very similar. Started in high school. I played baseball, was in the band, but had this part-time job that really turned into something that I loved. And very similar to him, I worked for Chick-fil-A, Inc. At the time, it was just the interim manager program. But when I went through it, they call it the Leadership Development Program. I'll reference it as LDP. But you run company-owned restaurants, and you help new owners open up their restaurants. And you travel anywhere from 24 to 30 months, full-time, 50 weeks out of the year, and living out of hotels and living out of rental cars. I did that with two kids. So if you can survive a two-year-old, a newborn, and a Hilton Garden Inn for 2 months, you can do anything in the world, I promise you. But some of these are my assignments, from Missouri to San Diego to Marietta. I'm sure you're familiar with that one. And then Atlanta. And then one of my favorites was the Truett's Chick-fil-A in Noonan, Georgia. I got to lead a new restaurant concept that protected Truett's legacy, but also with a modern twist. So as you can see, it doesn't look like a normal Chick-fil-A. But I spent 27 months on the road, traveling, doing running company-owned restaurants as an interim, and also partnering with new owner-operators to help start their business, select vendors, train their team, answer any questions. And we had 15 business days to teach them the business, and then we were on a plane to the next assignment. So it was a pretty cool program. It definitely sharpened me a lot. But that's my story. And then after the program, I fell in love with Southern California. Was in San Diego for a little bit, and I was like, hey, I hate pollen. I'm ready to get out of Georgia. This fits me perfectly. And so we've been loving and leading here for 2 years now at my restaurant in Westlake. So really, to dive into Chick-fil-A, we need to talk about one man first, and that's Truett Cathy. He is our founder. He grew up as a product of the Depression. His dad was a cotton farmer. His family moved to Atlanta, and some of the first housing projects in Atlanta, I think it was called Techwood Homes, I believe. But his mom ran a boarding house. So at a very young age, Truett learned about hard work. And this is Truett here with his hands in his pockets, his brother Ben. But he learned about hard work. He learned about hospitality. He helped his mom in the kitchen a lot, shuck corn, shell peas, all that good stuff. And that's where his passion really was born of it. And even to this day, we sell Coca-Cola pretty exclusively. And Truett liked to tell a story that when he was 8 or 9 years old, he would actually buy a 6-pack of glass Coke for a quarter, take it on a little red wagon, go door to door and sell it for 5 cents, and he'd be able to make a nickel profit. So he likes to say, or liked to say, that was why we partnered with Coca-Cola. Not because Chick-fil-A is an Atlanta-based and Coca-Cola is an Atlanta-based. From then, him and Ben opened up the Dwarf Grill.
Yeah, I'll talk a little bit about that. So this tiny restaurant was called the Dwarf Grill. It was right across from the Ford plant in Atlanta, which was right next to, at the time, it wasn't the busiest airport in the world, but it is now the busiest airport in the world, Hartsfield-Jackson International, Atlanta. Lots of pilots and airline staff, and also people that are building Ford automobiles. This place has anybody ever been to a Waffle House? We don't have any out here, but okay. Waffle House,
Denny's.
Short order grill.
Is that a thing?
No, maybe. Not quite. So this was the type of place where you walk in and you've got like, you know, 8 bar stools and then 4 two-top tables, and they're cooking the food right in front of you. There's a server that comes around to take your order. You hear that server call the order out to the cook. The cook's making it right there in front of you. They've got eggs and grits and biscuits and, you know, steak and all kinds of stuff. That's what the Dwarf Grill was, and it opened in 1946. This is the place, and the title of our talk has a little bit to do with inventing the chicken sandwich. Some people may think, really? I've heard of a chicken sandwich before there was Chick-fil-A. Well, there was not a commercially sold fried breast of chicken sandwich when Truett invented this product in 1964, and this is the restaurant that he invented it in. He had a lot of people from all over the country and all over the world even that were eating at his restaurant so close to the airport, had the opportunity to test that out with a lot of people.
They gave him a lot of feedback too. And then finally they said, like, stop messing with it. Like, it's great. You know, it'll beat any competitor as of recently. It'll beat any competitor.
The last thing they said was he had the whole sandwich and it was just the bun and the chicken. And they said it needs something like a little like tang or something with a little bit of a zip. They said, how about pickles? And so he added the 2 slices of pickles, which, does anybody order their sandwich without pickles at Chick-fil-A? Yeah, occasionally? Man, I always eat the pickles. Yeah, love it.
Nah.
So one more story about the Dwarf Grill is Truett lived, he rented a house right next door, and everything was gravel when it opened up. And the reason he rented this house is his restaurant was open 24 hours a day, 6 days a week. So at midnight on Saturday, it closed. It was closed for 24 hours, which was commonplace, you know, back in the 40s. But he lived right next door with and heard the gravel driveway. So he always used to tell the story of how he would go to sleep. And if he heard a lot of gravel kicked up from the cars pulling in the middle of the night, he'd hop up, you know, wash his hands, throw on his uniform and go over there and help them out. So the drive and entrepreneurial spirit that he had to kind of start this little thing from nothing and to see what it's become is just really incredible.
Yep. And so Chick-fil-A was really born after that chicken sandwich. And in 1967, Truett actually opened up, and he's known kind of as a pioneer for bringing restaurants into shopping malls. So he opened up in 1967 in the Greenbrier Mall in Atlanta, Georgia. This is a picture of it. And he actually had a lot of pushback from developers of shopping malls because they were like, hey, it's going to smell like it's going to, like, I don't know if our shoppers are going to like that. And Truett was very persistent with it, ended up putting it in, being a huge success. He started sampling and it started growing like crazy. So the 60s, 70s, and 80s were pretty much a big boom. I mean, years of 40, 50% growth. I think we heard a couple weeks ago, like in 1982, if they were planning to open up just under 100 restaurants. And if we were to take that equivalent in today's, where we have 2,600 restaurants, that's like us opening 2,000 in a year. And so it kind of blew my mind when I was thinking about that growth. But the core strategy back then in the 60s, 70s, and 80s for Chick-fil-A was to ride the boom of shopping malls in America. So they started popping up all over the Southeast, and it was some unprecedented growth.
Yeah, I was telling you earlier, my restaurant was in a shopping mall, and it actually opened in Fredericksburg, Virginia in 1978. It was location number 297, at the time, shopping malls were kind of the new downtown. It was the place where people went to go get their shopping done and run errands and that sort of thing. My mall even had a post office in there, which is kind of crazy. But that you could not get Chick-fil-A outside of a shopping mall all the way through 1986. 1986 was when Chick-fil-A tried this new kind of stretch project that was really kind of an unusual thing that they were going out on a limb just trying to figure it out. They opened this location, North Druid Hills in Atlanta, as a freestanding location. This is what we kind of call the second wave of our business, because in the 80s, people started migrating a little bit away from the kind of mall, and as we got into the 90s, you guys probably know that shopping malls took a really big hit, and a lot of big box stores kind of became the norm. And so the next wave of the business was going to be taking Chick-fil-A and taking that experience to the people where they are. So they opened up locations all over in communities close to housing and schools and all those types of things, so that they could serve people. They also added that big benefit of having the drive-through, which was still kind of a new and up-and-coming thing when they opened that. Yeah. The first location that I worked at in Marietta, Georgia, was the sixth freestanding location. So we had a basement, had to carry stuff up from the basement. That's where our storage was and all that kind of stuff. It looked actually almost exactly like this, except there was a playground on the front of it. It's been remodeled since then. But yeah, this was the second wave of our business, was the addition of freestanding restaurants. And now, as you can imagine, there are about 300 mall locations left, and over 2,000 freestanding locations today.
Yeah, and so Chick-fil-A today, y'all see us in the news. We're one of the most positive viral brands out there. Have y'all ever seen like the folks on the treadmill with the meme, like chasing after cars, things like that that go viral, which is pretty cool. But we're ranked up there and on Glassdoor as a great place to work. We're the third largest restaurant chain in America now, behind Starbucks and McDonald's. And we do it in 6 days, not seven, and with less restaurants too.
We double, right? Most closest competitor in a week. We double them in sales, mm-hmm, in 6 days of business. Yeah.
So it's pretty cool, and you know, we're very blessed with great team members, great guests as well, and great communities that support us as well. So a little bit about Chick-fil-A. Hopefully, that you've seen that differentiates us from other fast food restaurants is our products. And if you look at the Chick-fil-A logo, once I put it up there, the A at the very end of it is capitalized, Chick-fil-A. And at the time when the logo was written, it represented grade A eggs. And so it represented fresh food and premium products. We use Oreo in our cookies and cream milkshake. We use Hershey syrup. We use white lily flour in all of our hand-rolled biscuits. Hopefully you've had one of our biscuits. But they are hand-rolled every single morning. And then every piece of chicken that comes through our restaurant, we hand fillet it. So that's like taking the piece of chicken, making it that heart shape that it is. We do every single piece of chicken that comes through our restaurant, we hand fillet it. And then lastly is our lemonade. Who has had our lemonade? All right, it is great, it is fantastic. Even the diet lemonade's made with Splenda, but it is rinse, wash, cut, and squeezed and made in-house. We still, today, are the largest purchaser of sun-kissed lemons in the country.
A lot of them grown right here in Ventura County,
yeah,
that are shipped all over the country to provide that lemonade.
Yeah. Yeah. So the next time you have a glass of lemonade, just think like somebody was pressing hard and squeezing that lemonade. Our current roles, Josh, you want to touch on that?
Yeah, so currently Steven and I are both owner-operators, and the reason we put this up there is to talk a little bit about the slash there of owner operator. So a lot of quick service restaurants that you go to, you'd be pretty hard pressed to actually meet an owner. In fact, a lot of them are owned by groups, or you have like a bunch of people that are part of an LLC that would own a lot of locations. But Chick-fil-A is one of the rare, there's only a few, where you could actually go in and most of the time you can meet the owner. That person lives in the community where that location is personally invested in the success of that single location. And Chick-fil-A is convinced that the reason we have been able to be so successful and have that consistency is that we have local ownership. So we have a big brand, we have a very well-known brand in Chick-fil-A, but we're all locally owned. So the success of the Chick-fil-A on Moorpark Road is how I pay my mortgage and feed my kids. So I'm personally invested in the success of that specific location. And that location is my reputation in our community.
Mm-hmm. Good.
So the Chick-fil-A agreement, a lot of people ask this question. Actually, yeah, I'll talk about it really quickly. I was gonna say maybe I'll wait for questions, but I'll talk about it really quickly. So to open your own Chick-fil-A, you pay Chick-fil-A $10,000. And then for the life of the business, Chick-fil-A takes 15% off the top as their base operator service fee, and then you split the net profit 50-50 once all the bills are paid. So, and we may have some more questions about that later. I'd be happy to answer those or talk about that offline, yeah, if you'd like to.
How many other franchises do you think you can get for $10,000?
Virtually
Virtually none, right? Yeah. It's definitely for folks like me that grew up through Chick-fil-A, it gives that local ownership and opportunity for somebody to not necessarily have a ton of money in the bank, but to really do a good job and make an impact and to run a meaningful brand.
Yeah, Chick-fil-A is looking for great restaurant operators, not people that necessarily have the capital to build a restaurant and fill it with equipment. And so, the cool thing about that is I was 25 years old when they handed me the keys to that restaurant in Fredericksburg, Virginia, and they trusted me because I had proven to them that I knew how to run a restaurant. They trusted me to run that restaurant and kind of prove to them that I had what it took. So.
Yeah. All right, so now we're going to change gears to the how. We call this the create raving fan strategy. And raving fans are people who come more often, pay full price, and tell us and others about Chick-fil-A. So this is the how. And then we're going to kind of break that up into the leadership piece of how we lead our businesses. I like to say tend it and keep it. So this is how we cultivate and tend it with the raving fan strategy, and then we keep it with the leadership model. Okay, so this is it in a nutshell. Create raving fans, it's got three pillars: operational excellence, second mile service, and emotional connections marketing. Here you can see kind of a quick description of our role: select talent, build community, develop skills, and grow results. And then the description of raving fans. So to dive in, operational excellence is just that. Do y'all have a favorite restaurant other than Chick-fil-A? Shout it out if you got it. What's your favorite? Thai food? Well, what place specifically?
A non-franchise.
All right. It's got good food though, right? All right, what else?
In-N-Out.
Olive Garden, what?
In-N-Out.
In-N-Out, right? They got friendly people. They're very attentive, very courteous. If you think about your restaurant that you love, they get the first mile stuff right. They get exactly what you would expect right, because we technically are in the restaurant business. So we got to have good tasting food. We got to have friendly people. We got to be fast. We have to have a good ambiance, a great clean ambiance. But I think we're open for 95 hours a week, correct? And so it's tough to do this, but it's not something you just reach. So you constantly are tweaking. You're constantly getting better at it. But if you can build good habits around these four principles, you start to develop trust with guests. And they start coming back more often because they like the friendliness. They like the good tasting food. So to boil it down, you got to be really good at what you do, because we are in the restaurant business. What we do is sell chicken. Why we do it is to have a positive influence on all who come in contact with Chick-fil-A by what we say and what we do. So to that, we'd love for you to watch a video. His voice is Truett Cathy. And hopefully it's loud enough.
I'm not sure what mediocrity really means, but to me, it sounds like to me it's kind of a bad word, a word that I don't want to be associated with. I have no desire to be another McDonald's or Burger King or Kentucky Fried Chicken. I'd rather have one place and do a good job than have hundreds of places where 10% of them are not doing their very best. So I ask you to ask yourself, are you performing at your very best? And it's surprising the miracles that take place when we're performing at our very best. If I should ask you if you had a choice of achieving success or achieving excellence, which would you choose? There's a lot of people that achieve success, but generally success is only a temporary arrangement. Success comes and goes, but excellence endures when success moves on. What do you want Chick-fil-A to be? I want Chick-fil-A to be a great company, but you have to understand that a great company is a caring company. It's your responsibility to live up to the reputation that we tried to capture back in 1946, and treating your customer, treating them just like you'd like to be treated. We have a great opportunity to influence the lives of other people, and I would hope it would be for the influence of good.
All right, so the first pillar, do y'all remember? What was it called? Do you remember? operational excellence. The second piece is really what differentiates Chick-fil-A.
Yeah, Chick-fil-A, our product is really great, but you know, people can copy products. That's definitely something that can be copied. What we feel like we have a competitive edge in is this second pillar, which is second mile service. So those are just what you see there. We try to be genuine, proactive, and personal. And when I'm training new team members that are coming on to my staff, I tell them to follow their warm-hearted impulses. So when they see an opportunity to pop the door open for someone that's walking up, they should do that and say, "Welcome to Chick-fil-A," right? I think a lot of times in the food service industry, there's this tendency for it to seem like it's purely transactional. I have money, you have food, I'm gonna give you money and tell you what I want, and then we're gonna give you the food, I'm gonna eat it and leave. I need it to be clean and taste good, but that's pretty much the end of it. We don't feel like that has to be the end of it for us. We feel like there's a lot of opportunity for us to engage and really build relationships with people in our community and really show care.
Yeah. So to boil that down, be passionate about the people. What we do is sell chicken. Why we do it is to have a positive influence on all who come in contact. We are in the people business. So that, another video. Here we go.
So we share this video with all of our new employees that start with us during our orientation, actually on some of those great TVs over at the Hub. off Landera. And you know, I try to communicate with team members that they're not just getting a job, like a part-time job for high school or college. They're joining a company that really wants to make a difference and cares about people. I mentioned earlier, sometimes it can seem really transactional, you know, in a quick service restaurant, and we're working hard to make it relational. One of the things that I talk to those new team members about is, you know, maybe it's 9:55, we're about to close, it's the end of a long shift, and you look up and you see a line form, you know, ready to take their order. Well, for a 16, 17, 18 year old, that can be kind of a bummer, you know, you're trying to close and get out. And I try to coach those people to say, you know, everybody standing in that, it's not just a line. Everybody that's in that line is a unique individual who has a very complex and complicated life, just like you do. You want to get out of here and go get on with whatever you have to do, homework or hanging out with friends or going to bed or whatever it is. Who knows what may have happened to that person? And if you can get a high schooler to think about a person in line that they're about to take their order who maybe has a visitor sticker from Los Robles on their shirt, and you can say, who knows what may have just happened to that person. They could have just had the best day of their life or the worst day of their life. And if you can really get that person to think about the guest that they're serving, it can really help them connect and really make that.
Yeah, because we do anywhere from 1,500 to 2,000 transactions a day. And that's just a swipe of a card. So we try to paint the picture that, hey, that is thousands of families, couples that we can have a positive impact on. It's not just about the money. It really is about the word care. And so the second mile service piece to the middle of the strategy is a core belief of us to go the extra mile, to understand that every life has a story.
We want to give you the opportunity to ask some questions, so we're going to go through this slide really quickly. But basically, we look for opportunities to build relationships in our communities. So the Ventura County Operator Team specifically has partnered with an organization called Raising Hope that provides financial assistance to foster children and foster parents in our county. We've partnered with them for a 5K race, a 5 and 10K race that they do every year. That's a fundraiser for them. That's one of the examples. We've also partnered with all kinds of schools and organizations in our community to help build that relationship so that we can connect with the community on a more personal basis.
Correct. And so that's the Raving Fan strategy. The second pillar of the how, and I'll cover it pretty quickly, is that we are committed to the leadership piece of not just having a general manager that runs the restaurant for us, but having strategic leadership structures in place so that, hey, people are trained properly, trained well, and then they leave and the next person comes in that they're cared for and trained well. And we do that because great leaders know and do this. They serve. I truly believe servant leadership is the only leadership out there. Everything else is just a boss. Servant leadership is the only thing that is out there. Everything else is just a boss. So we have this acronym that we use at Chick-fil-A. It's called Great Leaders Serve. They see and shape the future, have the vision and the action behind it, engage and develop others. I recognize that I'm the only person that's going to be with me forever, so my job is to engage and develop my team members, my leaders, so that they can go off and do amazing things. And we reinvent continuously. What did you grow last year?
22% up 22? Last year over 2017.
Yep. Yeah. I grew 18% last year, growing at 19% in sales this year. So we constantly have to rethink things, our systems, our processes, our drive-through layout, how we serve, to reinvent continuously to keep growing. And then we value results and relationships because obviously you got to keep the doors open, make a profit, but we value both and we try to find the balance on the scale. And then lastly, we embody the values. Like for us, at our restaurant, we have four values: selflessness, excellence, energy, and industriousness. That is the language of our culture. That is what we look for in team members when we interview them. Are they going to fit into our culture and our values? So with that.
Yeah, just really quickly, a little bit about Chick-fil-A tomorrow. If you live within about a 5 to 8 minute radius of either my restaurant or Steven's restaurant, you can open up the Chick-fil-A app and order some food, and we'll bring it right to you between the hours of 11 a.m. and 8 p.m. On-demand delivery is kind of the newest trend in the food industry. If you've ever ordered from DoorDash or Grubhub, well, we use DoorDash all the time. We're also looking for opportunities for how can we own that delivery channel ourselves.
Yeah, Chick-fil-A gives opportunities for operators to help figure things out. Like the best way they believe that we can get a system going is like give it to a group of owner operators and say, hey, figure this out, help us out with it. And so on-demand delivery, there's only about 100 restaurants across the country that are doing it, and we've been selected to help make that a success for next year, rolling out chain-wide. And then obviously you've been through our drive-thru, seen the iPad use. We can have anywhere from outside the restaurant, 7 or 8 people just working to move the line through it. And then the middle picture there is at our corporate office in Atlanta. They have 2 full restaurants, and that's a guy in a car going through the drive-thru as a simulation. So, all right, question and answer time.
Let's give the guys a round of applause first.
Thank you.
Okay, so we've got 2 microphones going. So, while I hand the microphone to some, we'll start with Naomi, and she can ask a question. Keep your hand raised, and Greg will get you the next mic.
Why are you closed on Sunday?
So we believe, and it's been let me back up. I think there's been two core principles that Chick-fil-A has rolled out that have been key to the business and the health of the business. One being closed on Sunday, and then us saying it's my pleasure after somebody says thank you. And I think we're biologically wired to go to sleep every night, so it's very healthy for us to get rest and for the restaurant to get rest. But it is a day of rest for people. It's so kids can go do homework. I mean, spend time with family. I know I probably wouldn't be in the restaurant business if I had to open up on Sunday. It is a huge perk to sleep in and hang out with family.
Yeah, I mean, the perk that it adds for people actually in the industry. So if you're, you know, being served by someone, the odds that they have a weekend day guaranteed off every week is super low. So to be able to provide that for our high school and college age students is a really huge perk, and it's something that's very appreciated. It's something that, you know, means a lot. Truett was closed on Sunday. In the 40s, everything was closed on Sunday. That was just how, you know, that was how things worked in the South. And he continued that tradition as Chick-fil-A continued to open. So people have the opportunity to do a lot of different things. So people can go to church, people can spend time with their family. It gives us the opportunity to get together our teams. And just a few weeks ago, I paid for everybody to go to Six Flags. We do a sponsorship with Six Flags, and I got some discount tickets and took the whole team to Six Flags to spend the day together. There's a lot of opportunity for some great team building stuff too.
So. Yeah, we were at the Hub on Sunday.
Thank you, guys. So you mentioned that the agreement, the franchise agreement is 15% top line, and then it's you share net profit 50% with the corporate office. So for people who want to be possible franchisees for any food brand, what kind of metrics should they be looking at to decide whether they want to get, let's say, every 4 weeks there's a royalty and a marketing fee of, let's say, about 6-7% for every period of 4 weeks? Or should they go more, or should they look, what metrics can they identify to decide whether the Chick-fil-A one is better than the other, or vice versa?
Versus a Subway versus a,
right,
you know, whatever.
I mean, really the Chick-fil-A is a different kind of franchise agreement. It doesn't really exist. Like we were talking earlier, it's an opportunity for people to get in that are great restaurant operators. That's tough to say. I will say that Chick-fil-A gets about 40,000 expressions of interest a year, and they select about 100 Chick-fil-A operators. So it's this, you know, obviously 10 grand, anybody can tap their family and friends and come up with 10 grand, right? So it's not the financial commitment. In fact, if you decide after a year that you're not a fan, they'll give you that 10 grand back. It really is a partnership where you own the business and the employment liability, and Chick-fil-A owns the building and the equipment. So it's a great company to be a part of. I will say that 65-70% of the people that become Chick-fil-A owner operators have some Chick-fil-A restaurant experience. So Steven and I both worked for Chick-fil-A for a long time coming up. I have a gentleman named Brad that works for me who's graduated from college 3 years ago. He wants to be a Chick-fil-A owner operator, and he's working for me for a period of 3 or 4 years to kind of learn the ropes and learn the business and then go and apply to be a Chick-fil-A operator. But I also have a friend named Dakota who's in his final interviews right now, and he just retired from the Coast Guard after 20 years, and he's getting ready to interview for some specific locations in Southern California. So it's a little bit of a different opportunity. I would say it's less of an equity and wealth building type play and more of a, you know, full-time job. I mean, it's putting your best effort into running probably one location for your time with Chick-fil-A. So I think if you're interested in building a portfolio and having a restaurant be one part of your portfolio, Chick-fil-A is probably not the best way to go. There are other franchises. If you can get the loan or you have the capital to do, it probably makes more sense. But if you're committed to being a local business owner, running a restaurant that people can have a great experience in a community like that, I think Chick-fil-A is a great fit.
Yeah. And if it's piqued your interest, I'd say the best bet is to go talk to a local Chick-fil-A owner operator. Come talk with us. We'll have our cell phone numbers up here at the next slide, so take it down. Feel free to come see us.
Put them up. That way they have it. They know this is Q&A.
There we go. All right.
Feel free to give us a call anytime.
Like, if anybody, say, if they want to know how or why they maybe should look at a Chick-fil-A, tell them to come talk to us. Go to Oxnard, go to Ventura, go to Valley.
There's a guy named Nate Freeman who just got selected to take over a location in the Bay Area. And his first interaction about the Chick-fil-A opportunity was to come to my restaurant and go to the restaurant at Chick-fil-A in Oxnard and talk to Matt, the franchisee there. And he just kind of learned about it and then went through the process.
Right. So thank both of you for coming out here. That's awesome. How do you pick your charity that you support? And where does the chicken come from?
So we pick charities. I have kind of like a three-pillar strategy. A lot of youth-based and education and leadership-based, and then any extracurricular activities for my restaurant specifically. That's where we kind of differ as franchisees, but we partner a lot with the schools, so it's run through that filter, really, for us. I don't know how you pick yours.
Is it because you were approached?
Usually, yeah. We probably get 3 or 4 emails a week about donations and things like that. So we talk about it, strategize it, see what the budget looks like. But we try to run it through that filter first. Yeah.
I have a question over here.
Oh, wait.
What was the second? How do I select? I mean, honestly, kind of the same way. Somebody emails us, somebody comes in from Thousand Oaks High School or, you know, CLU. People are looking to raise money. A lot of times we give them kind of swag, like what you guys got today with the little cows. We do like a gift basket, or we'll do like VIP tours where we bring people in and feed them for free and then give them a tour of the kitchen and let them see how it kind of all works. Yeah. Most of it comes to us, honestly. It just comes to us. Oh, the Raising Hope. Yeah, so they came to us and asked if we would be like a corporate sponsor of that 5 and 10K race that they did. They didn't do it this year in 2019, but the previous 3 years, we were one of their sponsors, and we took our big cow mascots. And so, yeah, we kind of had a little bit of a personal connection because the person came in and was a regular customer and said, hey, would you help us out with this? Would you want to be a part of it?
Do you have to run that night corporate or anything?
No, that's all up to us.
Yeah. That's all us.
Oh, yeah, we have multiple suppliers across the country. So, I mean, Pilgrims is one of them that we see a lot, but there are suppliers kind of all over the country. Chick-fil-A just announced no antibiotics ever. We had a 5-year plan that started back in 2014 to convert our entire chain to no antibiotics ever throughout the entire process.
Hit it about a month ago.
Yep. So. A little bit early, and
it's cool. All right, I can't remember who was next.
Thank you guys for coming and sharing your guys' experience with us. A question I have is, two-part question. First of all, is it true you can only own one Chick-fil-A? And the second part is location. What's the process of picking a location? Can someone who's interested choose a location, or is it something that corporate more has in line?
Yeah, so the one location, the cap right now is 3 locations, actually. So you can't own more than 3. The selection process to get a second or to get a third is as intense, if not more intense, than the process to get the first. So yeah. I had 10 in-person interviews at the corporate office or in the field before they handed me the keys for that tiny little mall restaurant that was contributing about $1 million a year in sales. To get a second location, you have existing business results that they're able to talk about and look at. They're able to meet your leadership team. It's not just you, it's an entire team of people that they're able to kind of interview and talk to. Yeah. So yeah, but 3 is the cap right now.
And for the second part, it is a healthy balance of, hey, what are your regional preferences? What fits you and your family, your kind of just a personality fit, chemistry fit as well. Like, I chose Southern California, and we love the beach. Like I said, I want to be by a large body of water. That's something my wife wanted, so that was a non-negotiable. So we could go, and we were lucky to get next to the beach here. But you put in a regional preference with them, and from there you start the dialogue. But it is, we don't get to just choose the selection. In fact, we go through focus interviews where they pitch the top 3 candidates for one location, and then they pick the best fit from that.
So Chick-fil-A has, even like, we have a regional office in Irvine, And there are three people that work out of that office that handle like California real estate deals. So they are actively working on all those kinds of things, and they'll tell us when there's a spot that may be coming close. But as far as influence over where the location goes, we don't really have any influence over the specific building.
Hi, I'd be fascinated to hear about your potential career path. It sounds like you could get a maximum of three, then would the next step be corporate office, and then ultimately at retirement, are you able to sell your businesses at a profit and cash out?
Yeah, so since you pay $10,000 to get in and you actually don't have any equity, you don't build equity in the business. Chick-fil-A, I've been there for 5.5 years at Moore Park Road, and Chick-fil-A still owns the building and owns all the equipment, and I lease it from them monthly. So there's not anything that I don't own anything to sell. My LLC owns a couple of things, like a car, but I don't own anything with the building. So, no, I would say for Chick-fil-A operators, some would choose to work towards having multiple restaurants, so having two or three. That's a great career path. If they ever open up a location in Newberry Park, you can guarantee that I'm going to be knocking on the door, hey, I'd like to have that one. Some Chick-fil-A operators do choose to pursue a career at the corporate office, and there actually are, most of the people on the executive committee have actually run a Chick-fil-A location before as an owner-operator. And maybe they were always looking for a corporate position, but there are plenty of field consultants and people that work in Atlanta or in Irvine at the regional office that started out as Chick-fil-A owner-operators. But I would say having two or three locations, most people, most operators that do that, that would be kind of the pinnacle of their career. So there wouldn't be like a, I'm going to stop doing this and then go work at corporate. That's probably pretty rare. But someone who maybe has been doing it for 5 or 10 years may see an opportunity at the corporate office that would be a better fit for them, for sure. It's really a partnership between the corporate office and us. So we're kind of two sides of the coin. And sometimes we, if an operator goes to work as a field consultant, we say you went over to the dark side. It's kind of like a little inside joke in the company. But there's a really healthy relationship between us. But it's a different role. It's a lot of different responsibilities. Yeah. And I think most operators got into it because they like working with people and being a part of a community and running a restaurant that really makes, you know, lives in that community.
It makes you not want to retire. But it is, like he said, two sides of the same coin. And I think Chick-fil-A corporate is a very good steward of operators with tenure. And so they leave a lot of that decision making up to the operator of like, hey, how's your health? How are your buckets, your life bucket, your physical bucket, your health bucket, all that. And they really just start the dialogue from there of like, how are you doing? Have you thought of it? And then from there, the operator kind of takes it and decides.
I heard a rumor, maybe Camarillo soon?
Maybe. We call it green dots, right?
They put these green dots on the map, you know, as okay, like potential where they'd like to be. And Camarillo has been a green dot for a long time.
Yeah, where the America's Tire store was.
Oh, hey.
Chick-fil-A and Starbucks, that's what I heard. It's okay. Like the dream team.
I have not heard that one, so.
Fingers crossed.
We've got one back there.
Recently, there have been a number of studies looking at what appears to be a reduction in lifespan in the United States, and other studies showing, you know, pandemic levels of chronic disease, and the millennials showing early signs of cardiovascular disease. Do you think that the restaurant industry has a responsibility as entrepreneurs yourself in that business, in terms of the really the health aspects of the food that you're serving?
Yeah, I mean, Chick-fil-A spends a lot of time developing healthy menu options. I do think we have some responsibility to be providing those types of options for people. I mean, I always say, like, if you come to Chick-fil-A and you get a fried chicken sandwich and fries and a milkshake every day, you're going to be in trouble. And I'm there 5 or 6 days a week, so believe me, the opportunity to get that delicious fried food all the time is tough. But we have a lot of great options that are really healthy options, whether it's, you know, lower calorie, lower sugar. A lot of the moves that Chick-fil-A is making to be more sustainable, the no antibiotics ever movement, the hard work that they're doing to remove any kind of MSG or additives and make the ingredient list that we have as clean as possible, are all steps in the right direction. And I think, you know, Chick-fil-A as a company is going to respond to trends in the industry. So as a customer becomes more selective, and I think a lot of that is even driven a lot by the California consumer. I mean, it's a lot of Chick-fil-A business nowadays. I think as those trends change, Chick-fil-A has adapted pretty well to those changes.
Yeah, like even from a seasonal product example, we have like a lemon zest salad coming out next year. We got a kale crunch side that's coming. So we're very cognizant of it. And I think Chick-fil-A's one word is to care. And so they want to care about all aspects of it to have a positive influence. And that starts with what we eat too.
Yeah, if you're going to get a milkshake, let that be a splurge item that you do occasionally and enjoy it. Don't let that be your regular drink with your, you know, number one meal. But, you know, something Chick-fil-A did several years ago before I even moved here to California is they changed up the kids' meal option. So they added a grilled chicken nugget option, which is an incredibly healthier option than fried nuggets. They also changed the structure of the pricing. So a kid's meal comes with fries, you know, as a default. But if you want to change that to a fruit cup, it's no additional charge. If you'd rather have an applesauce, it's no additional charge. And the beverages, apple juice, which is, we have organic apple juice that has no added sugars, and 1% milk and chocolate milk, also at no additional charge. So I think they're really looking out for families who want to make healthy choices for their kids to make it easy and not feel like they're paying a penalty to do it.
And a dedicated department with corporate responsibility kind of around that too. So.
Yeah.
So a quick comment and then a question. The comment is just, I want to congratulate you both. We live in Westlake and I work in Thousand Oaks. And I think you have the most interesting drive-through process. It kind of spins you into a small little knot where you have to order or your car explodes or something. I'm not even sure how that works.
It has happened.
It's especially Westlake, by the way. You probably lead the pack there. But you get all the orange cones, which is kind of cool, too. Right. So, now, the question is you're running a business within a franchise. You have an operating agreement. You have to abide by the tenets of that. I mean, if you could, I'm sure you have to go to bed at night sometimes thinking, gosh, if we could open on Sunday, I'd go from 19% to 30%, you know, and that's a temptation, right?
It is.
But if you got a memo from Chick-fil-A and they said, today, for one specific thing, you each get to do whatever you want to do, absent the charter, absent the operating agreement, it's your wish list. It's the things that you singularly and collectively talk to each other about, go, if they would only do this, what would it be?
Ooh. All right, so the first thing that came to mind for me.
No,
I'm going to tell them. All right, I'm going to squat. No, I'm just kidding.
This is politically incorrect.
Okay, so
but it's okay.
I think it would be fun for the team to serve all the off-menu items. That was the first thing that came to mind. Like some of the things that we don't sell to the public, but they make for break, things like that.
So
I think
like an In-N-Out, like they're secret menu.
Yeah, it's not a secret menu, but like team members do it.
Like they're chefing something in the kitchen
for their break,
going on their meal break,
something
right.
like that.
They're putting things together and making like quesadillas or, you know, mixing
Chick-fil-A
different
pizza,
things.
Like random stuff.
Some of the
that
stuff is pretty cool.
Are creative with,
but we can't sell it. We have like the menu and there's a couple of alterations, but that's
right.
That's
I
it.
Think that would be fun for the team. I would like to see that. It'd be kind of cool. And just give it to whoever comes in the drive-thru, I guess. I don't know.
Mine immediately went to reducing complexity because even though our menu isn't as expansive as some, you know, quick service menus are, it's still a lot. There's a lot of options. And so mine immediately went to, I'd cut out anything that was like not a good profit contributor or a low selling item and just try to make it easier on the employees so that they can produce it faster. Because if you've ever sat in the drive-thru and at my location, we've pulled you up to that sign or we've pulled you around to the parking lot for you to wait for your food, it's because of a complexity issue that they're dealing with. Like they ran out of something that was one ingredient that they have to go prep more of. So that would probably be my thing, is reduce the complexity of the menu.
That's a good one. Yeah. That's a great one. Good question. not us.
So I had a question for you. You guys kind of talked about that the business model is such that you're you get basically you buy into the income stream, right? But longer term, it didn't sound like once you left that there was anything for you guys. I was curious, is there any kind of, at the corporate level, any kind of stock options, or do they make stock available? I know it's not a private or public company, but do they make stock available to you guys to buy into the company?
No, they don't. There's not. They have had people in the past that have been on like pensions, pension programs. They have some like early retirement options where they've you know taken care of people that have been with Chick-fil-A for a while. But no, I mean ultimately we own
that part to plan.
Yeah, I mean hopefully I'll do this till I'm 75. I don't know. when I finally hand the keys back over to Chick-fil-A, they say, "Hey, thank you. This was a great partnership." And if I haven't planned well for my future, and I don't have some, you know, rental properties or good investments and that sort of thing, then yeah,
you're out of luck.
So you really, like you said, buying into the income stream is a perfect way to say that, because it's a company that's got a lot of proven track record and is growing a lot. And so you're jumping into something, and then that money is coming through, and then when it's done, it's done. And my restaurant will go to some other franchisee whenever I choose to retire.
Yeah. I think she's got one right here.
Thank you both for being here. This has been really, really interesting. I have two questions. So there's Chick-fil-A's abroad. Are there different menu items in Canada and the UK than there are here? And then the second question I have is, what does Chick-fil-A corporate do for quality control? What are they doing, putting you guys through, each of the franchisees through, to make sure that everything's up to par?
First one out, is there a menu change with Toronto?
No, in fact, I think it's the same, or it may be slightly limited. There's not any like Canadian specific items. They have started to investigate that though, because really you gotta think, once we start opening more like in Europe and Canada and then in Asia, there's gotta be some consideration at least of that.
I think when we go to Hawaii, we will have some things to reduce complexity and maybe a couple different things.
To ease up on the supply chain a little bit too, because you know, we have a very established supply chain.
Yeah.
Sorry, what was the
second
question?
Part? I forgot.
Oh, quality control. Yeah. So, yeah, we have Chick-fil-A hires a couple companies. Right now we're working with Steritech and Deloitte. So Steritech comes in and does a quarterly unannounced food safety evaluation at every single location. They put us through the ringer. It's way more vigorous than a health department inspection. Tech checking every single temperature, checking the cooking times and the refrigeration. And then Deloitte is more of the quality control company. So they come through, again, quarterly. It is announced, but they come through and walk through with our managers or with us, and just evaluate the product and the processes and make sure that it's being done according to the Chick-fil-A specifics.
And then there are some electronic resources as well that we can set up systems and processes to check daily, weekly, monthly, as we would like to.
Well, we do a daily safe critical, which is a food safety evaluation that we do at least once a day is our requirement from Chick-fil-A, where somebody from my team walks around with an iPad and answers a series of questions that have to do with food safety, talking about hand washing, cooking temperature of chicken, and checking some of those things, and it's like a rotational basis. And so we do six of those at minimum a week to make sure on the food safety side. But I mean, any of my employees can pull up their phone. There's an app called Pathway that they can log into, and it gives them the specific quality requirements and videos and training for anything that they want to learn how to do in the restaurant.
All right there.
So we got two more questions.
We have one here and then one there.
Yeah, hi guys. Thanks for coming in tonight and talking to us. Anyway, first question is, a lot of the fast food industries out in this area and even in LA are offering their employees 401ks and medical and so forth. For even part-time positions, they're offering some benefits. What about Chick-fil-A at this point?
Yeah, So that is a little bit of a difference there up to what we choose. Like for us, we do offer 401k through Chick-fil-A for our full-time employees, part-time if they partake in it. But we do medical benefits as well. Like for my restaurant, I offer $400 toward the Chick-fil-A, different structures that they can opt into and they can budget accordingly. But that's specifically me. I don't know.
Yeah, so for people that work for me that reach the top level of our organization, the director level, that is currently seven people that work for me right now. I pay their full ride health insurance on like a midline Anthem Blue Cross Blue Shield plan. So they don't have to pay a penny for their own health insurance, and they can also get it for their family if they choose. Most of the people that aren't in a top-level leadership position probably can get cheaper insurance, even if I'm subsidizing it, honestly, through Covered California. So that isn't really something that makes much sense for us. But the 401k, actually, it's funny that you bring it up because I just was doing a little bit of research because next year it's something that I've already told my team, and it's mainly the leaders that would be interested, that we're going to be offering that next year because it's a pretty simple... I thought it was way more complex than it is. It's a pretty simple thing to do, and I don't know why more people don't do it. Yeah. So we are going to start that next year.
When you say that, are you matching? Or?
Yeah, we'll match. So we're going to do like a 4% match of it, whatever 30%. They contribute. Yeah. The Chick-fil-A.
A little more generous than I
have. You know, got to give a little more. We got the dining room.
Yeah, that's true.
But some Chick-fil-A owner-operators, like the Chick-fil-A in Hollywood, they offer a 3% match, and you don't even have to contribute. So based on sales volume and profitability and that sort of thing, different operators offer different kinds of things. Tuition reimbursement, scholarships, all those sorts of things. Everybody that works for me can apply for a Chick-fil-A scholarship, which is a $2,500 scholarship, and they can get it up to 4 years. So I tell these high schoolers when they start working for me, hey, if you stay with us a couple years in high school and then you go to school and you stay with Chick-fil-A, you can get $10,000, and it is a competitive scholarship, but it's like you have to have a 2.5 GPA, and you have to be in an actual like accredited college or university. But you could have $10,000 paid for just from Chick-fil-A Inc. Through that scholarship, which is a great perk for them.
So we have our last question up front.
Yeah,
sure. So it's kind of a two-part question. The first part is, who do you believe is your biggest competitor, like which restaurant chain? And also, do you believe that corporate picks locations based on where their competitors are? So if there's a lot of your competitors in one area, do you think corporate would not put another location right there?
So for the first part, I'd say not necessarily fast food restaurants, but quick service restaurants. So gentleman here was with Sharky, so that type of model where it's order, sit, and dine, that kind of deal. So looking at like Chipotle and that category, Panera, I think those are our greatest competitors right now. Yeah.
But you know, I mean, there's still just tons of customers that we share with McDonald's.
Yeah.
I mean, it's we like to think we're in a little bit of a niche where we're kind of in between like a fast food restaurant and a fast casual restaurant. But a lot of we share a ton of customers with, you know, McDonald's and Taco Bell and those types of traditional, you know, quick service fast food restaurants. As far as Chick-fil-A's kind of real estate strategy, man, I think Chick-fil-A has changed. When we first started opening locations in California, they were like, ooh, the price of real estate is so high, let's just find a spot and put a location. And so there were a lot of these locations that opened up and nobody knew where they were. First of all, nobody in California had ever heard of Chick-fil-A, so they were like, what kind of place is this? And then you couldn't even find it because it wasn't like it was easy to get to. Probably 10 years ago, and Hollywood was one of the first ones that was kind of this new model where Chick-fil-A said, we're going to go for A real estate locations. We're not going to just try to enter the market in like a B or a C location. We're going to go for A locations. So no, I don't think Chick-fil-A avoids competitors. I mean, Southern California, In-N-Out. I mean, In-N-Out is super regional, right? So we don't have that competition over the rest of the country. But in Southern California, In-N-Out's a big competitor. And yeah, Chick-fil-A will plop a restaurant down right next to an In-N-Out.
If it's an A spot, yeah.
Yeah, if it's an A spot, for sure. In fact, there's a location down in close to San Diego in San Marcos. and it's like a parking lot that has a Chick-fil-A and an In-N-Out and like a barbecue restaurant and a grocery store and all that, and yeah, they're not afraid of it for sure. Sometimes it maybe even makes more sense just because the customer is already in that area, so when you present a new opportunity, it's, you know, maybe good for that location.
Let's give the guys a big round of applause. Thank you very much.